Now, with your Bibles open to Acts chapter 16, I've got only a few minutes to cover. Would you find Acts 16 in James chapter 1? In Acts chapter 16, we're going to continue our talk on the Holy Spirit in the book of Acts. And in Acts chapter 16, we left off at verse 25. Here's what it says. And this will fit too. This, what we're going to share is some things about faith. What do you do in faith for the trials of life when things aren't going the way that you want them to go and they go rough and they go, you know, maybe you're being sent to a city that you don't want to move to, you know? But do you follow the Lord? Here's what verse 25 says. At midnight, Paul and Silas, remember they're in prison, backs are ripped open, they're in pain, they can't sleep. Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's chains were loosed. Paul and Silas are in a lot of pain. They have been accused of something that they didn't do. They've been arrested under false pretense. They've been punished under false pretense. They're now in prison, deep in an inner cell, and they begin to pray and they begin to worship. We talked about worship and the power of worship last week. But now what happens is, during this time of prayer and this time of worship, an earthquake comes. And the earthquake doesn't just shake the buildings, it actually takes all the chains that are on people's wrists or ankles and they fall off. That is an amazing earthquake. I mean, what earthquakes show up with keys to locks? You know, and just start unlocking everything. But all this stuff fell apart, and the doors are open. All the doors opened up. And it's so amazing that none of the prisoners run. They just freak. They're just looking. And then look what happens. And the keeper of the prison, verse 27, awakening from sleep, seeing that the prison doors open, supposing the prisoners had fled, drew his sword and was about to kill himself. But Paul called with a loud voice, saying, "Do yourself no harm, for we are all here." Then he called for a light, ran in, and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. And he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" So they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household." This guy was about to kill himself, and he found out everybody's there. He runs in there and says, "It's such a miraculous thing. What must I do to be saved?" Paul says this, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved and all your household." Look at verse 32. "Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house." That means that the guy took Paul and Silas to his home. And while they were in home, at their house, he's telling them about the word of the Lord. He's telling them about Christ. He's preaching to everybody in the house. "And they took them that same hour of the night and washed their stripes, and immediately he and all his family were baptized." So they believed the story. They believed what Paul had to say. They nurtured him. They took care of him and Silas. They washed their wounds. They bandaged them. And then they had a water baptism ceremony. And it's night. What time is it? 4 a.m. now? Nobody has slept. Remember, at midnight, we have the earthquake, and then there's the salvation of the jailer, and then we're coming over to the jailer's house, and everybody in the house is hearing the word of the Lord. They're getting saved. Now we're going to get the jailer and all the people in the house baptized in water, and look what happens. And it says verse 34, "Now when they had brought them into his house, he set food before them, and he rejoiced, having believed in God with all his household." So what took place here is, now they're having breakfast. Nobody has slept all night long, which is pretty amazing. But here's what's happening is, how did all this begin? How did all this start? I see that there were two amazing miracles that took place. One is, all the chains of all the prisoners fell off, and all the chains in the jailer's mind fell off too when they received Christ. The big question that we have is, are you going to let God's miraculous power come into your life and knock the chains off your life? Are you going to be able to take the restraints that are holding you back from following Jesus with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might, and go forward like the jailer is doing? Are you going to be able to take away the restraints that are in your life to follow Jesus and to do what Jesus wants, just like Paul and Natalie are doing? Are you going to be able just to be free of the chains or the bondages of your flesh, of this world, of your life, so that you can move into what God wants in your life, the blessings of God? But how did all this begin? This all began with Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas are in prison, and they begin to pray and worship. They knew that God would deliver them, but they didn't know how. They knew that they would be delivered. They knew God would come to their aid. They believed in God. They had faith. They had faith. They were believing God for big and mighty things in their life, but they didn't know what would happen. A lot of times when we go to prayer, we start telling God how to deliver us. Okay, God, I want you to do this. Here's what he wants you to do. I have actually had people do this. Would you pray that I be healed because I don't want surgery? Think about that. My prayer request is based off of fear, not faith. I really despise surgery. I don't want to go under anesthesia. I don't want them to cut me open. I don't want to go through the process of recovery. I don't want to go through a healing process. I don't want to miss any time at work. So would you pray to get healed so I don't have surgery? Okay, there's a little confusion there. Because is your request coming more from fear, or is it coming from faith? Because of the power of God. I think when we begin telling God how to deliver us is when we start telling God how to drive the car. Nobody likes driving with other people telling them how to drive. Nobody. It doesn't matter who's sitting in the driver's seat, whether it's mom or dad, whether it's husband or wife, whether it is boyfriend or girlfriend, whose ever turn is driving, they don't want to hear, I would have turned there. Why'd you make that turn? Why don't you go straight? There's a parking spot over there. I've never met one person who enjoys, oh, that was such a lovely thought. It really made me fuzzy all over. Why do we do it with God? Why do we tell God how to plan our future? Why can't we submit to Him? Why can't we say, what's your plan? And I will follow it. Why do we say, make it this plan? Because I sure don't want that plan. Why do we do that? It's because we lack faith. And we are stronger in fear. It's the fear of the unknown. And if God will do it this way, I'm comfortable with that. I know that journey. I can walk those steps, and I'm okay doing that. But don't take me into a place that I don't know, into an area I may not be comfortable in, because I'm not going to like that at all, God. And it comes from fear and not from faith. Then there's another side of where Paul and Silas are at. Paul and Silas are in a situation where it is very difficult. They are facing trials of life. They are facing difficult situations. They're having a troubled time. Anybody here having any troubled time in life? Melody over here is part of our G2 team. Her husband is leading a small group, and she's pregnant. At the same time, she's fighting MS. And she went through a month of just very, very horrible, horrible symptoms of MS. And the small group that is involved, that she's involved with, are constantly praying for her and covering her in prayer and holding up her in prayer. But she's in a difficult season right now of life. She's got to believe God. She's got to look to the Lord. She's got to quote the scriptures. She's got to focus on the Lord and not just focus on every symptom that shows up. She's in a battle. She's one that I know of, and I know of many. Doug Picard, who is our coordinator of Sunday worship, he's our worship service coordinator. He's a major leader in our church, just came home from the hospital yesterday. He came home from the hospital because he had his spleen removed because they found a growth on his spleen and they thought it could be cancerous, so they did a surgery and removed his spleen. He's going to be out of work, they say, up to 5 weeks. And he just got home and surgery went well, but he's in a battle. He's in a fight. Wayne Scott over here, his wife Cindy, who's recovering because she was in the hospital this week. She had something happened, you know, that had to do with her bowels, and it was shocking, and she lost blood. I mean, she's a little lady, and they gave her a pint of blood. I mean, that's like 2/3 of what she has, you know. It's kind of like having a V8 engine or a four-cylinder. You know, the four-cylinder takes less oil than the V8. Well, you know, Wayne's the V8. He's got a lot of blood. Cindy's the four-cylinder. But she's now at home recovering. She's getting better. She was in the hospital for a couple of days. You know, in those moments, what do you do? They're scary moments that you're like, whoa, what happened? And what do you do at that moment is very important. And Paul and Silas are at that moment. What do you do? The book of James tells us what we should not do, and I would like to share with you. Paul shows us in Acts what we should do. In the book of Acts, we should go to prayer. We should go to worship. We should call on our friends to pray for us. We should turn to the Lord. We should look to God. But in James chapter 1, would you turn there? Go to James chapter 1. It tells us how you should handle yourself during this difficult, difficult time. If you're going through a troubled time, if you're going through a troubled time in life, and in worship, in pressure of life, here are some things that you need to do. James chapter 1, look at verse 12. Blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. In fact, back up to verse 2. Look at verse 2. Here's what it says. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. So what is verse 2 and verse 3 talking about? Not a trick question. Brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. What is the subject matter of verse 2 and verse 3? Trials. Faith in trials. Trials. Count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Okay, could we say that we're going to talk about various trials? Could we say what to do in trials? It says, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work. Now drop to verse 12. Blessed is the man who endures temptation. The word for trial in verse 2 is the word trial, temptation, or testing. Verse 12. Blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised for those who love him. What's the subject in verse 12? Nobody wants to answer. Okay, this is going to be an open book test. Okay? Verse 2, the answer would be, the subject of verse 2 are trials, testing, and pressures of life. Verse 12, it is going to be, a blessed is the man who endures temptation, or testings, or trials of life. Verse 2 and verse 12 are talking about the same thing. Is it possible? James has not left the topic of tough times in life or trials. That everything in between verse 2 and verse 12 are also talking about that. That's where I want us to go and look at verse 13. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. Still on the topic of temptation, trials, pressures of life. Going through a tough time. Like Cindy did this last week. Like Doug did this last week in the hospital. Like Melody is doing. You know, she's carrying her child. How many months pregnant are you now? Almost 7? Way to go, girl. So proud of you. And then it says, so we're talking about these pressures of life, just stuff that goes on. People who are finding it, you know, are going through a pressure of life that has to do with your job or your relationship or your health. Here's what he says. Let no one say when he is tempted, And the word for tempted means to be tested or tried. I am tested, tempted, or tried by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. Of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we might be kind of first fruits of his creatures or creations of his what he has done in his creation. I want to let you know we haven't changed the subject yet. We're still on the trials of life. The entire first chapter deals with trials of life, pressures, difficult moments. Look what he continues to say. So then, my beloved brethren, so then. Okay, how many people walk onto the stage and come out and they're about to deliver the word of God and say, so then? No, the so then is referring to the stuff that I just told you about. Here's what I've told you so far. The trying of your faith will produce patience. Count it all joy when you're facing difficult times. Do not blame God for the difficult times. Verse 12, 13, 14. So then, now that we have an established fact that every good and perfect gift comes from above, that he's the Father of lights, so then that you understand that the trial will produce faith, and that pressures of life and the difficulties of life are not coming from God, but God is the one that's on your side helping. So then, now that you know that, do this. So then, my beloved brethren, let every man facing pressure of life, difficult situations, all of a sudden trauma coming on, a big pressure in your life. So then, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath, for the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God. In the middle of your trial, keep your mouth shut. Do not get angry and believe God. And it continues. Therefore, again, it's not a new topic. It's not a new subject. It's still the same thing. Trials of life. Are you going through a difficult season in your marriage? Are you going through a difficult season in your employment? Are you going through a difficult season of your health? Is it finances? Whatever it might be in life. He says, first of all, make sure that you count it joy that you are a believer and that you're going through a tough time because your patience is going to get stronger. And he said, next thing is verse 12, don't blame God, but realize God is the one that brings good things into your life and he's going to bring light to you. And now he says, make sure that you are swift to hear. In other words, be listening for the answer. Slow to speak, don't talk real quick, don't jump in with all your conclusions and your opinions, and be slow to anger or to wrath, because your wrath will not produce the righteousness of God. The righteousness of God is the answer of God. It is the deliverance of the situation. It is for you to make sure that you find out what God wants in your life. Your anger during the situation at God is not going to produce the answer that you need, the righteousness that you need. It's not going to produce what God is doing in your life. So we look at this. Here's what he says in verse 21. Therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. Be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror, for he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it, the perfect law of liberty is that you have been liberated by what Jesus Christ did for you, not what you have done for you. Your liberty is found in Jesus. It is found in the Word of God. It is, and he says, and continues in it, and it is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work. This one will be blessed in what he does. If anyone among you thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this one's religion is useless. Here's what he's saying in all these Bible verses. In order for you to get through the seasons of life that produce difficult trauma situations, number one, be quick to hear from God and God's people. Number two, be slow to speak. Number three, be slow to wrath. In other words, don't get angry. How many times has somebody, when they lost their job, they got mad at God? When they faced a sickness, they got mad at God. Now here's what happens. When you are in a trauma situation and you get angry and your anger is looking at God like, why did you let this happen to me? You are not in a position to hear the answer that will give you the righteousness that will walk you out of the problem. You now have to deal with your anger. You have simply slowed the process down. You now have to deal with your anger. God's going to deal with your anger. First thing is to say, what are you mad at me for? What are you mad at me for? I'm the one that brings good things. Do you remember it says in the book of James? All good things come from me. There's no shadow of me. There's no turning. I am light. You know, like some people say, I'm black and white. Well, God's just light. There is no darkness in him. He is an open book. In fact, he gave you a book to open. And his book says, I am here to help you. The problem is when you face difficult seasons in life and you turn your anger to God and you start getting mad at God, like, why did this happen, God? Why'd you let this happen to me? Or you're just mad at God for because you're going through a tough time. Now God's got to first, okay, pause everything. Angels, stop. Okay, let's deal with your anger. Come on. Let it out. Sometimes a good cry helps get you through that time. Sometimes, you know, some people, I don't promote this. They hit the wall. Sometimes you hurt yourself. Sometimes you hit the wall and there's a stud on the other side. You're going to break a knuckle or two. It's like, no, these outbursts of wrath. James is saying your anger, your wrath doesn't produce the righteousness of God. And what you need at this moment is the righteousness of God working in your life. You need to be able to be slow to speak, quick to hear. In order for you to do these things, you have to be quick to hear from God and God's people, slow to speak, slow to get mad, and you need to receive with meekness the word of God that's going to navigate you through life's issue. If you think that from this day forward you're never going to have a problem in life, you're never going to have a difficult season in life, then you are believing a lie. This world has evil in it. Jesus even said so. He said, don't worry about the evil about tomorrow. It's going to be there when you get there. That's basically paraphrasing. Jesus said, hey, it's waiting for you. But what are you going to do today and the evil that you're facing today? And how are you journeying? How are you navigating through life right now? What pathway are you following? And it's going to have to be the Word of God. I would encourage you that when you are going through a tough time in life, a difficult season, get in a habit immediately to follow Paul and Silas's example in prison. And that's go to prayer and go to worship. Don't think that God allowed it, let it, caused it, or brought it on. You are in a fallen world that is full of sin and evil people. An evil darkness is trying to destroy you, and you're on their target. You are in their sights. They are looking to hurt you. So what you need to do, what you need to be, is to make sure that you are speaking the word of God. Speaking God's word. Speaking God's word. Singing God's word. Worshiping God. Praying. And then focus on asking God to journey you through this time and the season, and God will bring you guidance and wisdom through people and through the Word, through sermons and other means. But if you can focus on the Lord, you'll get out of it quicker. Until you do, you'll stay in the midst of it. You could just you know, you could just go around and around and around and around and around and around and around like a toilet that won't flush, but just goes around and starts filling up. Isn't that horrible? That is like the most disgusting thing ever. As the toilet just goes, it goes around, go down, no, don't come up. And then it starts to go over the top. And you know what that, nobody likes that. But yet some of you just need a good flush. Because the stuff you're carrying around has been floating in that water for a long time. And then you can start thinking clearly. The things of God. God is the answer to your problem, not the cause of it. If you embrace the doctrine that God is allowing this or bringing it in your life, you will have a very difficult time getting out of it. You've got to embrace the doctrine that Paul and Silas follow, prayer and worship, and God, where's my miracle? The miracle could be through a surgery. The miracle could be through a doctor. The miracle could be through an instant healing because you came up and got prayed for and the prayer brought that healing. The miracle could be a new job. The miracle could be a story like what's happened with Paul where he was released from one job and the next day he found out about us and the next day we're talking and then he gets hired. Your miracle is simply a belief away. So endorse, encourage, strengthen, and embrace the miracle working power of God. Let's close our Bibles, turn off our devices.